mercy of some of the biggest predators in the county. And one example of what happened to a little boy, he loved to play baseball, and he didn't want to join the gang, and he loved to sing in his choir, his church choir, and he said no to the Grape Street Crips. And on the third try, Connie, of him telling the Grape Street Crips no, they took his little sister, gang raped her, filmed the gang rape, and gave him the video.
Oh,
and I mean, yeah. I had never seen anything like that other than an execution. I had never seen anything that horrific. And it made me physically sick. And I will never, as long as I live, forget that. And I realized right then and there what had happened. Where had I been? Where was I when that little boy had to face those monsters by himself? And it was a real epiphany, and I decided right then and there that everything that was in my power to do, I was going to fight this violence, I was going to fight this cult of death, I was going to fight innocent children having to face these gangsters, and I was going to try and open the exit ramps out of the gangs and close the entrance ramps. And that's when I started my journey through gangland, Connie.
Ah, but in order to do that, you also had to sue the police.
Yes. Yes, at the time,
nobody was totally innocent in this world.
I know. It was a very, very hard time for LA. We had just been through the riot because of a reaction to the police beating of Rodney King. That videotape of that beating that was seen around the world, CNN, I think, aired it 200 and something times in a 3-day period. And it was kind of the curtain went up for elite LA. African Americans knew what LAPD was like in those days, and notice I'm using past tense because we're in another phase in our relationship with LAPD, I'm happy to say. But in 1990 and 1992, we were at war with LAPD. I woke up, Connie, I woke up every day and tried to think of a new way to sue LAPD. We were at war. We had over 100 lawyers with the police misconduct bar, the ACLU lawyers, the LDF lawyers, the MALDEF lawyers, and the Asia Pacific American Legal Center lawyers. We were an incredible law firm that we kind of created out of all of these nonprofit law firms. And we were representing victims of police abuse every day. And we were, in LDF, we were trying to change the culture through the policy challenges. So we did class action lawsuits. And we had 7 major class action lawsuits against LAPD. So you're right. We were at war with LAPD and the Sheriff's Department.
And there was something called the Rampart Division.
Yes.
I mean, it's been food and fodder for many mystery writers and thriller writers, but it existed.
Yes. And the gang units in LAPD were especially aggressive. And they ended up incubating a very sick and violent subculture. Now, gang officers do very, very dangerous jobs, mm-hmm. and they had these units called the crash units. Well, they unfortunately morphed into kind of an outlaw clique inside of LAPD, and we had the Rampart scandal. We had Rodney King in 1991 and the 1992 riots, and on the other end of it, in 2001, in 1998, at the end of that period, we had the Rampart scandal. And you'll remember the Rampart scandal was a gangster cop corruption scandal. And this unit of gang cops was planting evidence on people. They were lying in court. They were getting people deported who were witnesses against them in police complaints. They were an outlaw group of officers who planted drugs on people, stole drugs from the evidence locker, and once they got discovered through a plea deal that one of the officers who got caught, he said, "I will tell you everything." And when he started talking, we had a 10 on the Richter scale for police scandals.
We then had I liked him a great deal, Captain Bill Bratton. Bill Bratton was brought in from Boston to New York to Los Angeles. His wife also, Ricky, a lawyer. They were quite an asset to the city of Los Angeles. But Bill Bratton calls Connie Rice and says, "I have a job for you." After you had said to him in a discussion, "Why isn't the Los Angeles press saying what I'm telling you here?"
Well, Bill Bratton, when he came, was the last hope that we had of getting control of LAPD. We had just gotten a consent decree imposed. The book also tells the story of how that happened. My former partner at LDF was part of the Clinton administration. He actually imposed the consent decree after the Rampart scandal. And we had to get a new chief because Mayor Hahn was brave enough to unseat Chief Parks and clear the way. I helped him clear the way to bring in Chief Bratton. And it's probably one of the best things I've done for this region. At the time, Bill Bratton was known as America's police chief. He's still known as America's police chief, and he's known as a transformer. And he had been working with the court on the consent decree, and he said, you know what, I know how to turn LAPD around. And Connie, he really did. He came in, and he had enough ego and enough bravado and enough presence to be able to rein in LAPD's lawlessness. And he brought in, Ricky helped him, but I helped him. Who was very critical was Jerry Chaloff. He brought him in and made him a civilian deputy, almost at the deputy chief level. And long story short, Connie, with that consent decree, with Judge Gary Feist, with Jerry Chaloff in there, and with Chief Bratton and outsiders like me pushing every day, I went to LAPD almost every day. They gave me a parking spot. I was there. I said, this is our last chance to get this department turned around away from paramilitary policing that sort of terrifies the poor communities of color to a police force that protects the poor, protects First Amendment rights. And let me tell you something, long story short, you need to read it in the book because it is an amazing story. It didn't just happen with a consent decree. A consent decree means you're just beginning. Then the real hard work begins because you have to get in there and help that agency redo its DNA, redo its mindset. And with a chief like Bill Bratton, we finally had the chance to do it. It was an amazing run. And I tell this story. They had to lop out about 200 pages of it, so a lot of it got left on the cutting floor. But it's the behind-the-scenes story of how did it happen? How did we go from being at war with our police department to a point where, Connie, when my book came out, do you know who gave me my first book signing? It was LAPD. So I went from Chief Charlie Beck.
Yeah, and he gave it at, I'd never been to the police department before. And there, that building is gorgeous, and there you were, the star of the night.
It's how did we go from being at war with one another to becoming allies? And it is an amazing story, and I tell it in Power Concedes Nothing. And it's so hopeful because I never thought we'd get here. I thought that we might be able to lay down the war instruments. I thought we could maybe stop battling each other for a while because the commission changed, and with Mayor Hahn and then Mayor Villaraigosa, we had some real openings. But I never thought that we would get to the point where police wanted to change how they treated the community. And when Bratton was here, we could find the change agents, the cops who were ready to change. And here's the secret, Connie. If you help police change in terms that they can live with, in terms that help them become better cops, LAPD was ready to do that. And so I could go from being their opponent, their arch enemy, to their partner. Yeah. And that's where we are now.
Connie, where does Connie Rice go from here? Because I read it and I think, now, she should be either appointed to something in Washington or be running for some office or possibly a university. Where is the future?
Well, we're not done. And the children still aren't safe. I said, I don't get to retire. I don't get to go make money, which I should because I'm going to be a bag lady in about 5 years. But I really feel like we're at a turning point, another turning point. And if you leave the work now, here will be the sign of success, that the children in the gang zones in LA will be able to walk to school safely without confronting a gang recruiter, be in school and not have to avoid going to the restroom because the gang recruiters are in the school restroom. And then they will be able to go to a park and play soccer because the park is now safe and isn't run by the gangsters. And then they'll be able to walk home. Connie, if kids can't learn in a safe place and they can't walk to a park, we haven't done our job.
And we haven't if there is a little boy named Pygmy. who is used, and you said to him, what do you do?
Yeah.
And he said,
Connie, this was another heartbreaking moment, and in the book I chronicle how I met a child assassin. In L.A., it's hard to think, because we've got all the palm trees and the sunshine, and we've got Hollywood, and most of us are very safe. In my neighborhood, people walk their dogs at 11 o'clock at night. Most of L.A. is very safe, and it's hard to imagine that there are hot spots in L.A. and L.A. County where the gangs actually control the neighborhoods. And the shooting is so bad that sometimes mail can't get delivered. It's not all the time, and it's not the entire ghetto, and it's not the entire barrio. But what I realized in 1993 was that there's some areas of LA where there are children who are forced into the gangs and forced to work for the gangs. And the gangs explained to me, I met this little boy in a what passed for a restaurant in Watts, and I was with Fred Williams, one of the gang intervention guys, who I call my street Sherpas, because for a woman like me, you have to have a guide to the streets, and you have to have a guide through gangland, because you have no idea what you're doing, and you can actually get people killed if you don't have someone who really understands these neighborhoods and what's going on. Well, Fred had me at a meeting. Long story short, it was with a meeting of gangsters, and they had this little boy with him. And I was very concerned about the little boy, and I had him come forward, and they said, talk to the lady lawyer. The gangsters pushed him forward and said, tell the lady lawyer what you do. And he said, after some prompting, he said, I kill.
And with that, I can only say it is a brilliant book. It should be read, and everybody in government should read it to know what's true. Connie, will you autograph my book?
It's my
honor.
If
you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson. But support your library. If we have libraries that are open more hours, that will have better citizens, and they help people learn to read and read better. And we'll see you next time. Thank you so very much, Connie.
It is so wonderful to be with you. Thank you for having me.